Yeah, you can start like the life. Hello all. So I guess we will start now. So this is actually a part of the quantum week that we are having at PAE, and it is going to be am I audible? Okay, I apologize for all that delay. I actually haven't done this ever, so this is the first time. So I'll now start. So this is, as I've said, this is a part of the quantum week that we are having at PAE, which was supposed to be a week long, but now it has been decided that it will spread over a larger period of time. So I, in this presentation, will just present certain ideas on the Ising model, what it is, what phenomena it explains, etc. This is basically something that one encounters in their StatMech courses, probably in MSc or something. So the Ising model that we do is basically one of the most basic model where we encounter interacting systems. So it is a spin model, which has plus one and minus one spin. So we'll see that. And the spin actually, every spin actually interacts with its nearest neighbor. So that is why this is so different from, say, how we deal with ideal gases in statistical mechanics and stuff like that. So yeah, let's start. So first of all, let me talk about a bit of lattices. So in this we will mostly discuss about square lattices. So square lattices are, as the picture says, these kind of lattices, and at each lattice point there is actually a spin. So the question arises that what spin? So as we know that that atoms actually have electrons in their orbitals, and these electrons have their spins. So if the orbitals are half filled, the spins do not cancel each other, and we get a net spin of the atom. And so when these atoms sit on these lattices, they thereby have spins. So now the most general model is the Heisenberg model. So the Heisenberg model is basically the Hamiltonian, which is the energy function, which looks something like this. So H is equal to this thing. So here, this J is actually an energy factor, which actually takes into account all this. So we know spin is H cut by 2 times the Pauli matrices. And so this J actually takes in all those things and everything that is there. This is basically inside the J. and we are left with sigma I dot sigma j minus, and this is actually an external field that we can apply on the lattices. So that is the thing. And now the Heisenberg model is actually very difficult. So a much more easier model is basically the Ising model. So the Ising model basically only has spins in the z direction. So actually I have missed here. This will be sigma I z, sigma j z, and this one is sigma I. So what is this? So this is basically this symbol that is here. This actually signifies nearest neighbor. So if we take this spin, for example, this has four nearest neighbor, this one, this one, this one, and this one. So these four nearest neighbors, this is what this symbol here means. So when we write the Hamiltonian, this is basically the interaction term. So each spin has an interaction with its nearest neighbor. Now the Ising model, actually we can classify into two ways. One is the transverse Ising model, that is the field that is sigma hx, that means an external field we are applying h, which is in the x direction, and my spins are interacting only in the z direction. So this is actually requires a bit of quantum mechanics. Whereas there is another one which is called the semi-classical longitudinal, where the field is in the longitudinal, that is the field is in the z direction, in the direction of the interactions between the spins. So this is basically something that we can do a lot of things in classically. So this is called semi-classical because this shape of the Hamiltonian, this Hamiltonian function, this only comes through quantum mechanics. Since now in this case the sigma x and sigma z, they are not commutating as we know from quantum mechanics, so any state cannot be, so this is an Hamiltonian part and this is the interacting Hamiltonian part and this is the external Hamiltonian part. So any state, for example spin up state in the z direction, eigenstate of this, but it is not an eigenstate of that. So that creates a lot of interesting things, but we will mostly discuss this, which is not, which does not have these kind of features, which is the classical Ising model. So again, so the Hamiltonian is minus j sij, we can say now. So when the j is greater, so we see that this Hamiltonian has low energy, that is a more negative value if both the spins are in the same direction, if j is greater than 0, whereas it has a lower value, that is a minus 1, that is sigma I dot s I dot s j is minus 1, then this has a greater value, that is a plus j for j greater than 0. But if j is less than 0, then so if both of them are, one is plus, one is minus, then the minus minus cancels and this becomes J. And so for ferromagnetic, that J is greater. So ferromagnetic always have spins in same direction, whereas anti-ferromagnetic always have spins in opposite direction. So they prefer spins in opposite direction. So let us talk about a bit of history of this thing. So the Ising model was first, so the 1D version of the Ising, classical Ising model was first solved by Ernest Ising, who was a PhD student of Lenz, who was in turn was a student of Sommerfeld, so they are big people. So he solved the 1D model. So he basically found out that the free energy is analytical and therefore it cannot have a phase transition. So he basically conjectured, we can say that no dimensional, so 1D means that each spin has two neighbors, so it is kind of a chain, whereas 2D is it's in a 2D lattice. 3D model is basically when there is this thing repeats in even in the z direction. So there are few things. The spins are basically either plus one or minus one in z direction. So that is fixed in Ising model. But then the lattices can be 1D, 2D and 3D. So that's the thing. So then Onsagar showed that the 2D model actually has a phase transition. So what is a phase transition? We'll see it. And then so this one where HX is 0, that is either we have HZ or we don't have HZ. So both of them actually solved, I think, probably for HZ equal to 0. That is only this portion, only this portion. So there in 2D, 3D and everything that, after that, there is a phase transition. And the transverse Ising model, which is this one, which has a field in the transverse direction, that actually has many things which Ganesh and Nakul, I think, will discuss later on. So that's that. So let's move on. So before moving on, let us think that how can we think about this. So basically what we are going to do is we are going to see using Metropolis algorithm, we'll try to see how the magnetization, the energy, these kind of thermodynamic properties of a 2D lattice of this Hamiltonian, this classical Ising model Hamiltonian, how does this behave with change in temperature. So if we just look at the thing, first of all, this is j is greater than 0, so the lowest energy is when all the spins are in the same direction. So it could be all up direction or all down direction. So that is the case, and so that's that. So now at very low temperatures, since there is no external heat present, that much heat is there at very low temperatures, all spins will, we think that all spins will be at the same, will point, be pointing in the same direction. But as we increase heat, now heat is kind of a form of energy that brings in disorder with it. So as we heat it, we expect that these spins will start the lattice will show some form of disorderedness, and so certain spins will go down and certain spins will go up. And so we must see that as temperature increases, this thing, the magnetization. So what is magnetization? Magnetization is basically we sum up all the spins here. So this is plus one, this is plus one, this is plus one, this is plus one, and then we divide by the number of lattice points. So in this case, the magnetization is plus one, because everyone is pointing in the upward direction. If all were in the downward direction, it would be minus one, and if half of them were in downward, half of them were upward, then it will be zero, because plus and minus cancels each other. So we expect, so what we basically expect is that at low temperatures, it will all show an orderedness, all will point in one direction, and we will basically take the mod of magnetization. So plus one and minus one are the same thing for us. We will expect that everything will be in the same direction for low temperature, and as we increase temperature, as there is more disorderedness, the lattice will, the magnetization will go to zero. So that is what we think will happen, and so let's start with it. So what we'll try to do it using the Metropolis algorithm. So the Metropolis algorithm is basically an algorithm which exploits the canonical ensemble and the ergodic hypothesis. So what those are, we will see in a minute. So what we are going to do is that we will first, in a computer, we'll write an algorithm where we first off start off with a 2D array, which signifies the lattice. Now this lattice, basically, so then we will do a periodic boundary condition. Now what is a periodic boundary condition? Basically what we'll do is, so usually lattices are very big. So the solids that we see in our the solids that we see generally have 10 to the power 23, that is one, we deal in thermodynamics with moles, so there are 10 to the 23 factor order of magnitude number of particles. So doing that many things is not possible. So what we do is that we start off with either 10 cross 10 to 20 cross 10, 100 cross 10, 100 kind of lattices, and then we put a periodic boundary condition. That is, so in 1D case, what will be a periodic boundary condition? Since these edges are free, what we say is that we say that this has only one bond, but we say that this has actually a bond like this. So the first one and last one has a bond. So this actually becomes not a chain but a circle, a ring. Similarly, this actually we join this and this, and we join this and this, so it becomes first a cylinder, and then we join the ends of the cylinder, so it becomes a torus. So that is what a periodic boundary condition is, and then we invoke the Metropolis algorithm, which is what we'll discuss, to get the equilibrium condition of the lattice at a certain temperature. So we will deal with canonical ensemble. So what is that? I think I'll give a little bit gist about it. So what is the algorithm? The algorithm is basically this. First of all, we randomly start off with any condition. So it can be all up, it can be half up, half down. So it's randomly generated. And then we choose any spin. We choose a site at random. So here there are, I think, 9 sites. So we choose one site. There are 9 sites, so we choose one site at random, and then what I did was with 10 cross 10. People do with much larger stuff, so you can start off with you choose randomly one of the site, and then what you do is you flip that spin. So if it was in upward direction, you flip that to downward direction. If it is in downward direction, you flip it up to upward direction. So spins have only two. So each spin has only two configuration, either up or either down. So we start off with random, and then we choose one site and we flip it. So then we calculate this H. So this H is basically my energy. So before the flip and after the flip. So E initial is before the flip and E final is after the flip. So we calculate both of them and then we find a delta H. Now the algorithm is such that if delta H is less than 0, so if delta H is less than 0, so if the flip was is accepted. So earlier if it was upward, we just do it downward. So somebody asking, is it the Metropolis algorithm is the same as Monte Carlo? Yes, it's Metropolis Hastig Monte Carlo kind of an algorithm. So what we do is that delta H is less than 0, so we accept the flip, and if delta H is greater than 0, we do it with a probability e to the power minus beta delta H. Now how do we do that with a probability? So we understand that we can do it with a probability, but how do we implement that? That is, we implement by calculating this e to the power minus beta delta H, and then we select any random number between 0 and 1, because this value, since delta H is greater than 0, this value will be between 0 and 1. And so compare it with any randomly generated number between 0 and 1. And if it is greater, then the flip is accepted. And if it's less than, then the flip is not accepted. So this is basically the Metropolis algorithm. So this is actually repeated as many number of lattice sites as we have. So in this case, there is 9. So I did with 100 lattice sites. So 100 times this was repeated. And this whole process is called a sweep. Now, what does a sweep does is that a sweep basically changes. So in one sweep, the lattice actually changes to something new. Now these sweeps are actually supposed to be done for many times, probably 1000, 2000, 3000, 10,000 number of times. So that is something that depends on the lattice size. That is something that depends on on the lattice side. And I actually don't know how to actually find it out how many times. So I've basically done it by trial and error. So then, after a lot of sweeps are completed, say 1,000 or 10,000 sweeps are completed, we then get, but we still continue certain sweeps and we calculate these values. So now what we do in thermodynamics is that we can measure macroscopic observables. So magnetization is a macroscopic observable, energy is a macroscopic observable, CV is a macroscopic observable. So so we find out the magnetization by summing up all the in this case there are 9 sites. So we just add 1 minus 1 1 minus 1 like that for all the 9, and we find this magnetization. Similarly, that Hamiltonian function is put here, and we find the energy, and then we find so after 10,000 sweep we can do this. Now we actually, despite of reaching kind of an equilibrium, we still continue on with the sweeps, and probably we take 100 or 200 more such sweeps, and we measure these two quantities, measure M and measure E. Why? Because actually what it does is basically what we know as ensembles. What are ensembles? Ensembles are copies of the system. And so what we have done is basically by doing this probabilistic thing, what we have done is we have siphoned out the high probability members of the ensemble for us. So we'll look into it in a better detail, I think. So we have got all the members of the ensemble which have, so in this case, for example, if M equal to 0 is a state, so there could be many microstates using for which M equal to 0. For example, the first spin is up, second spin is down. That could be I'll talk about it in a bit. So we basically then repeat this sweeps and for more number of times, for probably 100 times, and from there we find out E average and E square average. So for 100 such sweeps, in the end we find out M, and we find out, so after doing 10,000 sweeps probably, we then do 100 more sweeps, and in those 100 sweeps only we find out M and we find out E, and then we find out E average and E square average over those 100 data points, and from that we calculate CV. So this is basically, and we have done this in a fixed T. So for one T we basically get these three quantities. Now there's one more thing that I think if somebody does it, they will see that many a times what happens is that the curves, the values of E, M and CV that we get are not quite continuous, which it should be in the real material. So what happens is that certain times the algorithm actually gets stuck in some other minima of the free energy. So we'll see about this. And so I'll provide some resources for this. So this is basically just giving an introduction. So sometimes what happens is that the whole system actually gets stuck in some minima of the potential function, from which is not actually the minimum. It is actually a localized minimum. So because of that, we get some discrepancies. But if this process is repeated multiple times, probably 10 times, and then we average out M, E and CV for a particular temperature, then we can remove those errors, those statistical errors. So then the question is, why does the algorithm work? So this is where the real statistical mechanics comes in. So first of all, there are certain so if you look at this lattice, for example, this is a small lattice, 3 cross 3. So there are some state. So this all up, this is actually a microstate. Now this is also a macrostate, but let us consider a macrostate where one is up and all the other ones are down. One is down and all the others are up. So that one of the spin is down and all the other spins are up. So how many ways that can be done? That can be done in 9 ways. That is n ways, because the up, the down can be in this position, the down can be in this position, the down can be in this position, and so on. So as we can see now, if we increase the number of downs, so if there were 2 downs and 7 ups, the number of microstate in that macrostate actually increases. In fact, if the number is half, so there are half n by 2 number of ups and n by 2 number of downs, that is the macrostate which has the most number of microstates. So one can do that calculation and find out. So what we are going to do, so that is actually the basic macrostate and microstate. And so what we are going to do is that we're going to take this lattice and put it in a, consider it that since it is in an environment which has a temperature T, we assume that the temperature is a reservoir. And so we deal with this in a canonical ensemble. So what happens is that, so there is actually a good discussion about this in Schroeder and Patria. So Schroeder actually says this. So suppose we want to make a system with an energy E. So how do we make it? We take the system at temperature T equal to zero. We just dump in all the energy that the system requires and the system is produced. Now, if the system has a temperature, has is connected to a heat bath at temperature T, we need not put as much energy as E, we need to put F, which is the free energy. So the formula is F equal to E minus TS. So the extra TS that is there, that is basically provided by the heat bath to get the entropy to S at a particular temperature T. So that's it. So basically what we are going to look at is probability of states canonical ensembles. So E to the power, in canonical ensemble, every microstate has a probability E to the power minus beta E. Okay, so in this lattice, we find out the energy, then we multiply it with beta, that is T dependent, so beta is 1 by kT. And then we take it to e to the power minus beta e, and we get the probability of finding that state. Now, what happens is that at low temperature, beta is 1 by kT. So T is very low, that is beta is very large. So e to the power minus beta e is a very small quantity. Now, if e is very low, that means all the spins are in the ground state. So the ground state has a higher probability than all the other states. So the ground state has a higher probability than all the upper states. That is what we can find out from this e to the power minus beta I. Now if we increase the temperature, what happens is that beta's value becomes very small. So this whole thing, so at ground state, this whole thing is very less for all the energies, and therefore this whole thing is kind of same for all. So the probability is every state is equally probable at very high temperatures. But then we saw that the case where n by 2 number of spins are up and n by 2 number of spins are down, that macrostate has the largest number of microstates, and therefore since all microstates are equally probable, the macrostate which has the largest number of microstates actually wins. And therefore at very high temperature we would expect that all the spins are down, half of the spins are down and half of the spins are up, that is magnetization is zero. And at very low temperature, since e to the power minus beta I, the probability, so then at very low temperature this becomes very low as E increases, and therefore at ground temperature has highest ground energy, has highest probability, and therefore the system remains at ground state. So how does this algorithm work is basically exploit this factor. So we find out, we basically siphon out all the, so at a particular temperature we basically funnel out all the states which have higher probabilities, and so that is why when h delta h is less than 0, that means the initial energy is initial energy is greater than final energy, then delta H is 0, and so we go to the final state. So this basically means that at lower temperature we tend to go to a lower energy state, and so I think that is that thing okay? I mean, so basically what we are doing, we access all the possible states only to keep those which are more probabilistic. So I think this is the algorithm basically does is it siphons out all the states which have higher probability. So at larger temperatures, every microstate has same probability, and therefore the m equal to 0 macrostate has the highest number of microstate, it basically becomes the state of the system. So this whole highest number of microstate thing is what we call the ergodic hypothesis. So what is it that AI ensemble, we have many microstates, and the system actually goes through all those microstates. Now, for example, say when temperature is very high, all the microstates of this spin state is same. Therefore, all spins in plus one direction, that is a microstate, and one of the spin, say in this position, is downward, that is also a microstate, or rest up, that is also a microstate. So everyone has a same probability, and so the microstates which have m equal to 0 have n by 2 number of spins in up direction, n by 2 number of spins in down direction. So that has the highest number of microstates. So that microstate has the highest number of microstates. So since the system passes through all the microstates with equal probability, the macrostate which has highest number of microstate, that will basically, as time averages, that property of that microstate is what we will measure. So then there is this discussion in all the standard books of path 3 and all. So as we said, that at low temperature the magnetization is plus 1, and as we increase temperature, the magnetization goes down to 0. That is, here all the spins, so half of the spins are in downward direction and half of the spins are in upward directions. Here all the spins in either upward or downward direction, and now this is actually H equal to 0 case. Now as we increase H, we see that initially all the all the magnetization will be in the same direction of the magnetic field, but as we increase temperature here as well, we see a phase transition. So this is actually called a phase transition, when the system is in an ordered phase where every spin is in the upward direction, to a disordered phase where everything is in the downward direction. We look at how energy is so energies are basically found out here, and we see that first it has lower energy. So as we have seen, that at lower energies, at lower temperatures, the system will have a lower energy, and as we increase temperature, the energy increases, and the system actually acquires a disorder, that is where half of the spins are up and half of the spins are down, that kind of a configuration. So and therefore, and now we know that if we differentiate this curve, we get a specific heat, and so here is the specific heat, and we see that the specific heat has a peak, and this temperature at which it has a peak is called the Curie temperature, after Pierre Curie. Now this Ising model is basically explains ferromagnetism, and in ferromagnetic materials we have seen the hysteresis curve. So how is this hysteresis curve is drawn is basically we do the same process, but we just do it for one temperature. We do it for three temperatures. What we do is that we provide this H, we change this H in the Hamiltonian, we change this H gradually from minus 1 to 1, and then do the Metropolis algorithm. So when temperature is less than critical temperature or Curie temperature, then we see that as we move along this curve, so this is basically what we see in ferrometals, ferromagnetic materials. So up to a certain H, up to a certain field, this remains, the magnetization remains at minus 1, and then it goes up and there is a phase transition. Not a phase transition, but the magnetization then becomes plus 1. And as, so I think we all are familiar with it. So this basically shows that the Ising model actually kind of describes ferromagnetism and it kind of describes magnets in general. So explaining ferromagnetism, ferromagnets with Ising model. So there is this theorem by Bohr and van Leeuwen. So Bohr actually, I think this was his PhD. So he and she, they basically found out that classical physics do not explain ferromagnetism, any kind of magnetic behavior, and so we need quantum mechanics, and that's why the Hamiltonian that we get is basically, its roots are basically quantum mechanical. And then since we have seen that we haven't done anything about states like you know, spin up or spin down kind of states. We basically what we did here in this whole thing is a classical way of looking into this. So this is actually called a semi-classical approach. We solved the Ising model where the field is in the z direction using a classical way, and this is actually called the semi-classical approach. And we see that that just like as we see in magnets, if we do a similar thing to the Ising model, we actually observe a hysteresis curve at t less than so as we know that if we heat magnets, they from ferromagnets they become paramagnets, and so that is what actually happening here. So ferromagnets have a strong magnetic property, and as we heat them, as we increase the temperature, their magnetization becomes zero, so they lose their magnetic property. Similarly, in this hysteresis curve, we see that there is a hysteresis loop for temperature lower than critical temperature, but as we increase the temperature, that hysteresis loop is lost, and we get a paramagnetic curve that we expect, the green one. So in this way, this kind of explains magnets, but it does not completely, because in magnets, as we know, there are domains kind of a thing. So this basically explains what happens inside a domain, but why domains are formed and these kind of things are not actually explained here. So this was basically a very brief walk through the Ising model. So the Ising model can be solved in many ways. This was basically using Metropolis algorithm. I'll just give some material for this. And so another way of doing it, so how Onsager and all those people did was through transfer matrix kind of a method, and there is also mean field approach. So that's that. And now then I'll just briefly touch upon the transverse Ising model, which will be later on explained by Ganesh in subsequent days. So the transverse Ising model basically has this Hamiltonian. So as we just saw, there is a field in the x direction, in x direction. So now an interesting thing happens. So up till now we could say that, so just look, so if we just look for one spin, let's just see one spin, we see that this one, if we have a spin up in z direction, these two Hamiltonian actually commute. Therefore, since they commute, they have the same eigenstates. So plus z and minus z eigenstates are applicable here, and therefore so we can just change these matrices to their eigenvalues. So for up spin we can replace them with plus ones, and with down spin we can replace them with minus one. But this thing, they since they do not commute, they do not have same set of eigenstates. So they are not very simple to approach. Now we still can do a classical approach to this. So will the classical approach work or not? That is a different thing. But it turns out that it kind of works. It is not very quantitative, but it is kind of qualitative. So what we are basically doing is saying that since there is an x, z, and s, x both component, we assume this. We assume that sz is like this, and sx is like this, and s is actually the kind of a thing that we. So this is actually called the mean field approach, where we assume that after the system is in equilibrium, there is a s in this direction, in a s with a theta angle with the x-axis, with the z-axis in this case, and then we write that the mean field E is this, and then E is minimized for this condition, so d theta, and what we get is something like this. So if gamma is zero, so this Hamiltonian zero, then we know that sz is basically s, so the sz is one, that is because s is one, and for gamma less than j, we see that sz and sx both exist and they are not equal to zero, and as we increase this, what we expect that the spin will go in this x direction, so this sz will become zero, and so that is what it happens. So basically now this actually creates an important, so now this is based on that the previous mean field approximation, we get a similar kind of a behavior. As we see, there is a phase transition at a certain temperature TC in the SZ, so SZ is 1, and then at a certain temperature it goes to 0. So this is basically that, one can do this. The most interesting part of this model is basically this. So what we have seen up till now is the expectation value of SZ, that is the spin in the Z direction, that value is always 1 at temperature T equal to 0. But if there is a transverse magnetic field, what can happen? So here we are doing is that we are making a new thing G. So H is basically, so G is basically H by J. So we are replacing, we are taking J common and putting a G as an thing. So if G tends to infinity, that means the zero state of this Hamiltonian is in the X direction. Because this field is in the x direction, and as this field dominates over this Hamiltonian, all the spins will lie in the x direction. And now x looks like this, so it is a superposition of spin up in the z direction and spin down in the z direction. And therefore, if we measure spin up sz, the spin up is half and spin down is minus half, so they cancel out. And so we get sz, if g is very large, we get sz is 0, whereas at t equal to 0, so we get paramagnetic behavior at t equal to 0, whereas if this thing dominates, if g tends to 0, we get our same thing, which is spins are either in upward direction or downward direction. And for g's value, where g is kind of 1, in that case, we get a mixture of x. We get a mixture of up and down. So in that case, s, neither sx nor sz are completely 0. So this property is actually called quantum phase transition, which we see at in the system for t equal to 0. And this is actually a very interesting thing that I think Ganesh will do. So the summary is basically that the classical Ising model. So here I'll stop. The summary is basically that Ising model is solvable. Classical Ising model is solvable, and there is no phase transition in 1D. So that was Ising found out. Later on, it was found out that, so 1D means in chains. There is phase transition, that is from ferromagnetic. So materials having the model having ferromagnetic property to paramagnetic property, that is magnetization becomes 0. So that phase transition is there as we increase temperature in higher dimensions. And at lower temperature, we see something like we can see this paramagnetic behavior due to quantum nature, due to transverse Ising model. And so the 1D, now here's an important thing, is that 1D Ising model can be mapped onto the classical 2D Ising model. And so if both of them are kind of square lattices or like that, then the nth dimension transverse models can be mapped to the n plus 1th dimensional model. And so I don't know the proof or the reason for this. And so that is where I will stop. So this was basically a introduction to what Ganesh will start. So references. I think the links will be given in the comments or description. So the thing is that the Metropolis algorithm, doing the Metropolis algorithm is a good thing. It's kind of easy. So there is these two GitHub, this GitHub link and this another link. And this book, I actually followed this book. So this is a computational physics book which has done the whole thing. And it has many more similar things in computational physics. There's also this NPTEL course, if somebody wants to read more about this, they can refer to Patria or David Tong lecture notes. He does it with mean field approach, and these two books, they are about quantum phase transition. And for next day, Ganesh is actually going to discuss this paper. So if somebody is want to look it up, they can look it up. This is actually the article that Ganesh will discuss. So I'll finish off here. So let's see. So I think that's all. So I'll end here. Thank you.